Welcome back, geology fans. The Earth began as molten mass, so the first rocks of this planet were certainly igneous, the rocks born of fire. Because the crystals form from a liquid, they tend to interlock with each other into relatively dense and tough rocks with no overall structure. That is, the minerals are jumbled and not lined up. We can take a slab of rock, glue it to a glass slide, and grind it down paper thin to use a light microscope to see details of the minerals making up the rock. Igneous rocks look like a jigsaw puzzle with their interlocking grains. This tends to make these rocks a bit denser and tougher than the sedimentary rocks, and the lack of crystals lining up distinguishes them from the equally dense, tough, and crystalline metamorphic rocks. But as we look over the igneous rocks, we see some have larger crystals than others. We refer to the size of an igneous rock's crystals as its texture. There are seven main textures that we can pigeonhole our igneous rocks into, and we start with no crystals at all. This is the glassy texture, and we can refer to this material as natural glass. Though we showed in the mineral overview that glass is not a mineral, it's close enough to make up a naturally occurring rock we call obsidian. Taking a step up, any igneous rock that does have crystals, but they are under 1 millimeter diameter, has an aphanitic texture. And though the term aphanitic means not visible, most of us can see the individual crystals as they get up to that 1 millimeter diameter. We will meet both the glassy and aphanitic examples in our future episode on the extrusive igneous rocks. Continuing upward in crystal size, the igneous rocks with over 1 millimeter diameter crystals, up to a few centimeters diameter average, have a phaneritic texture, and phaneritic literally means visible. The aphanitic crystals may be barely visible if you were close to 1 millimeter, but in general these rocks look duller in luster, and the phaneritic rocks have shinier crystal faces that are clearly visible. If we start seeing the crystals getting over a few centimeters, remarkably large crystals, the igneous rock has a pegmatitic texture. Pegmatite is Latin for a thing joined together, as each crystal is so big that it almost looks like its own rock, and so the large crystals look joined together in a pegmatite. The phaneritic and pegmatitic igneous rocks will be encountered in our next episode on intrusive igneous rocks. This gives us a clue as to what causes variation in crystal size. A rock that cools slowly underground has time to form large crystals, so the pegmatites cool the slowest. Then the phaneritic rocks cool a bit quicker underground, and then we erupt onto the surface to make extrusive or volcanic igneous rocks with aphanitic or even glassy texture. The faster the molten magma cools, the smaller the crystals in the resultant rock. Consider this as we meet our next igneous texture, porphyritic. If you have a bimodal distribution of crystal size, that is, two distinct sizes of crystals, then we say the igneous rock has a porphyritic texture. The name literally means purple, because the porphyry used in many ancient Egyptian statues was this type of igneous rock, porphyry that was purple in color. But how does a rock end up with two distinct sizes of crystals? We know large crystals require slower cooling and smaller crystals require faster cooling, so two distinct sizes of crystals are due to two different rates of cooling during solidification. If you begin deep underground, cooling very slowly, then come up a little closer to the surface where cooling can occur at phaneritic rates, we get a coarse porphyritic rock. And by the way, when we say coarse, we mean large crystals or grains, as opposed to the term fine for small crystals. An even more drastic change would be to start cooling slowly below ground and then erupt a half-frozen slushy onto the surface where the remaining liquid freezes with aphanitic or even glassy texture. When we get to the point of naming these rocks, porphyritic rocks are usually given the name of the rock for the finer-grained matrix, that is, the smaller crystals between the phenocrysts, which are the larger crystals. Okay, larger crystals are phenocrysts, smaller crystals are the matrix. So in this case, the matrix is what we would call basalt, and thus this rock is a porphyritic basalt, or basalt porphyry. We have a similar naming convention for our next texture, vesicular igneous rocks, which are rocks with frozen bubbles, as magma is not just molten rock, but dissolved gases as well, mostly water and CO2. Because these rocks have frozen bubbles, they are often exceptions to the idea of igneous rocks being more dense. Some of the least dense rocks on Earth are vesicular igneous rocks. So again, give the name of the fine-grained matrix and precede it with the adjective vesicular. This is a vesicular basalt, which, according to the Apollo 15 episode of HBO's From the Earth to the Moon, every geologist should know.
I didn't know a vesicular basalt had been filling your head.
And I do recommend all of you budding field geologists watch that Apollo 15 episode of From the Earth to the Moon called Galileo Was Right, which is about training astronauts on how to be geology field observers, and they do a pretty good job of it. So it's kind of like what we're doing here, so let's continue. The last texture is pyroclastic, which literally means fire-broken, as it is a rock whose parent material solidified from molten rock, but in the blast shock of eruption got shattered into fragments that later get glued back together. Often the rough, broken pieces are hot enough when they settle together that they actually fuse into each other. Ash beds are technically pyroclastic, as each ash particle is a fragmented piece, and pyroclastic rocks with larger pieces are often glued together with an ash matrix in what we call a volcanic breccia. That covers the major textures in igneous rocks, but there is one other major piece of information we need to start giving specific names to these rocks. That characteristic is the rock's chemistry, specifically the amount of silica, mostly in the silica tetrahedra, contained within the rock. In our minerals episode, we were frequently reminded that we have to be careful with color. But here in the igneous rocks, color is our friend. The dichotomous keys in our rock lab on iTunes U get down to the mineralogical details, which minerals appear in which of these rocks. And I find that starting that specific can throw many beginning geologists. You get bogged down in the details. So I suggest you just look at the color. And listen to episode 3 of the Earth and Environmental Systems podcast to refresh. We pigeonhole the magma chemistry into mafic, intermediate, and felsic. Rocks forming the mafic magma are made of the first minerals to come out of the Bowen's reaction series, which we met back in episode 14. The first minerals to come out are olivine and calcium plage, which give green and black colors respectively. Igneous rocks made of these minerals are said to be ultramafic, and they tend to be green with black specks. When phaneritic, we call it peridotite, and it is rarely aphanitic, but in such cases we call it basalt. But as we move down Bowen's reaction series to the mafic chemistry, we add pyroxene and amphibole to the mix. When phaneritic, we call it gabbro, and when aphanitic, it is basalt again. These rocks tend to be black to black-green in color. We next enter the intermediate chemistry, and the amphiboles and more sodium-rich plagioclase appears along with the first traces of quartz. The pyroxenes and amphiboles are black, and the more sodium-rich plagioclase is gray to white, and the quartz, too, is often gray to white. When phaneritic, this rock is called diorite, and it has a black and white salt-and-pepper appearance from our aforementioned intermediate minerals. When aphanitic, the blacks, grays, and whites of the intermediate minerals blend to a gray to cream-colored rock called andesite. When we reach the bottom of the Bowen's reaction series with the felsic minerals of quartz, some sodium plagioclase, muscovite and biotite mica, and potassium feldspar coming out. The K-spar, with its diagnostic pink to red colors, give these rocks the same tint. In coarse phaneritic form, we call it granite, and in aphanitic form, it is rhyolite. We should note that the three chemistry types are also commonly named by the aphanitic, extrusive, rock that they form. So mafic magma is also called basaltic magma, intermediate is andesitic, and felsic is rhyolitic. As mentioned previously, we use the adjectives of porphyritic and vesicular before the name of the smallest crystal size in the rock, and we use the phaneritic name followed by pegmatite for the really large crystals. This is an example of a granite pegmatite. As for the glassy textures, they really don't tend to form in the mafic and intermediate chemistries because the viscosity there is low enough to allow atoms to migrate into crystal lattices rather easily. But as we get to the felsic, rhyolitic chemistry, the viscosity increases to a point that atoms get frozen where they are without migrating to crystal lattices, and thus glass forms. So with this chart as our basic guide to our most common igneous rocks, we can start looking closer at each of our placeholder names, how they are identified, and what information they hold for us. When we come back next time, we will examine the phaneritic to pegmatitic textured intrusive igneous rocks that form down in the underworld, in the land of Pluto.